He walked out in the gray light and stood, and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold, relentless circling of the intestate earth. Darkness implacable. The blind dogs of the sun in their running. The crushing black vacuum of the universe. And somewhere 200 animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it. And lo, for the earth was empty of form, and void, and darkness was all over the face of the deep, and we said, look at that fucker dance.
Afraid of nuclear war, natural disasters, economic meltdown? Heat death of the universe could be the answer. It is 11:11 p.m. Korea Standard Time, March 30th, 2021. How's it going across the way, sir?
I just found out that you might be committing time clock fraud.
Me?
Time clock fraud occurs whenever an employee does something while punched in that is unrelated to work, while not on a 15-minute break. And I hope you're not committing time clock fraud right now to listen to this, because I doubt it's related to your work.
Is this coming from Amazon.
It's a place in my heart that doesn't want anyone to get in trouble.
It sounds like...
your bosses are watching.
It sounds like that ridiculous ball-busting, penny-pinching, break-dispensing, break-rationing stuff they do at, say, Amazon, for example.
There's some easy-to-do tips to avoid committing time clock fraud. You know,
help me
use the bathroom before you start work
to avoid lying to my shitty boss.
Make sure to take off your coat and jacket before clocking in.
Oh my God.
Make sure to secure personal items in a locker before punching in.
I'm still so angry at the coat thing right now. I can't even hear anything else you're saying. My brain is on fire from that. Okay, sorry, go ahead.
You have to arrive early to complete any shopping or other tasks before your scheduled start time. Once punched in, you are on the clock and you should immediately grab your equipment and head to the sales floor.
Wait, where are you reading this from? Right. What is this?
I just saw someone randomly post a picture of their back room at work with a notice of the time clock, and I had to read it.
Oh, this is posted by the where you punch in?
Yeah, sorry, I've got the image here.
That's crazy. I thought this was just a fucking listicle from some
No, this just reminded me of my life of back when I worked at grocery stores or worked at Barnes & Noble or wherever else I've worked in the past.
Oh, Jesus. It sounded like you were reading something from I don't know, a stupid fascist Medium article or something. Damn. Yeah, I see the picture now. That coat, take off your coat before clocking in. What is that? What is that saving in two and a half seconds at best? Insane.
I can't wait for my boss to come into my classroom and be like, you're not teaching right now, Jason. Rolling up your sleeves is not teaching. We're deducting your pay. What are you thinking? If you're going to roll up your sleeves, make the choice to roll up your sleeves before class starts.
Just stand there and take your jacket off and put it on over and over until it's time to go home.
I do that often, actually.
It makes the time go by faster.
I'm a terrible teacher, and I can tell that because I spend a lot of my time just standing in front of the class rolling my sleeves up, rolling them back down.
Teaching vital vocabulary up and down, roll and unroll. All right. So what are we talking about today? It's not what we were just talking about. It's other things. We're finally doing an episode that really fits snugly with the name of our podcast, I think. Talking about the end times, apocalypse, doomsday, and so on. More specifically, luxury doomsday bunkers. As a sort of offshoot of that, just the whole subculture of prepping. So got some stuff to talk about there about that. And then we're going to see into another topic, and you're going to hold our hand through that. What are we going to look at, Jason?
We're going to give you a little history lesson about the NRA and where the NRA is now, and maybe what I think about gun control.
Let's start off with this article I've got here in The Guardian. It's it seems like there were a few years ago that these articles started popping up a lot about these luxury bunkers and how like people in Silicon Valley and just rich people in general were buying plots of land in like New Zealand and other places, but I think New Zealand is sort of for some reason notorious for it, and building these basically underground mansions and whatnot.
Why New Zealand? Isn't that place kind of like a bunker in itself as far as the
earth goes? I think that's probably part of the reason they picked New Zealand, just the location being pretty far away from everything else.
Great weather most of the time.
Big spider maybe there's seed. Something to do with like property taxes as well. I'm sure there's all these like Silicon Valley people are such like weird penny pinchers, even though they're like also decadent at the same time, if that makes any sense. But and those were like from a few years ago, but this is more recent. This is from I think August 2020. And it's in The Guardian, entitled Weapons Rooms, Fake Windows, and a $3 million Price Tag Inside a Luxury Doomsday Bunker. I'll just start at the beginning. Mechanical level, medical level, store level, the voice announces as a lift descends into the earth. I'd entered at the parking lot level, the building's apex. I'm traveling through the inverted skyscraper. The floor numbers ascending, third, fourth, as we plumb the building's depths. A hulking man in his late 50s called Larry Hall stands next to me, whistling, black shirt tucked into blue jeans. When the doors...
He's not wearing a black shirt in that picture.
He is not. All right, I'm throwing this article out. This guy's a fucking liar.
That is not a black shirt.
Well, maybe they took the photo another day or something. I don't know.
There might be a black shirt underneath that shirt. I'm sorry. I'm off topic all of a sudden. When they say a skyscraper going underground, isn't a skyscraper too big?
Well, I mean, it's just trying to be like an evocative image of an inverted tall building. So, you know, as you're going down to and the numbers are going up, that's kind of, I don't know, trippy, dude.
Wait. I mean, I'm sure this is only a Google search away, but now I'm kind of curious what the, like, deepest basement is.
That is only a Google search away, I'm sure. I did, in all of the reading about bunkers, right. I mean, I don't have the info at the front of my brain, but I do think I remember coming across, like, the deepest bunker, at least, like, that's, there's probably deeper ones that are, like, classified, anyway, continuing
like
here.
The one in the center of the planet where they take the president if something bad happens to the Constitution bill.
Right. I've seen that movie with, I almost said Milton Friedman, Morgan Freeman.
Nicolas Cage.
The Core. No, I don't know. Whatever. I'm mixing up all these movies.
Oh, I was thinking of National Treasure with Nicolas Cage. I don't remember if there was somewhere where they took the president, though.
I don't think it was this core of the earth. Probably there is a really shitty movie called The Core where they go to the core of the earth to like kickstart it. It's sort of like that movie Sunshine, except it's inside the earth.
It's not as good.
Oh no, it's a terrible movie, and I've only anyway, we're so on track.
Well, Sunshine is what happens after the bunkers.
Yeah.
Way after.
I mean, I'm just drawing the comparison to like kickstarting like a giant heat source with like nukes, because I think that's basically what they do in the core as well. It's like the core of the earth has stopped spinning, which is just going to kill the earth. So they have to like go down to the core and like blast it up or something.
Jumpstart it. Take the red and black wire down there, plug it into the earth's battery.
Something like that.
Turn on the other earth. Give it a little gas.
How about the second paragraph?
Okay. When the doors open.
When the doors open, I can't suppress a laugh. In front of us, four stories below central Kansas, is a supermarket complete with shopping baskets, cold cabinets, and an espresso machine behind the counter. Hall smiles. It's good, isn't it? On the original blueprint for the renovation, it just said storerooms on this level. The psychologist we hired for the project took one look at that and said, no, 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 this needs to feel like a miniature Whole Foods supermarket. We need a tile floor and nicely presented cases, because if people are locked in this silo and they have to come down here and rifle through cardboard boxes to get their food, you'll have depressed people everywhere. That's going to be a bit of a through line of the article, too, is this guy consulted a psychologist for a lot of the construction of this place.
There won't be any depression as people wander down into their Whole Foods food store and over time start to notice the shelves more and more bare, like a winter storm had passed through, but the trucks never made it back. Till one day they're walking through their Whole Foods and every shelf is empty and they're thinking, where's the shithead teenager that's supposed to stock the shelves? Oh yeah, all of them died a long time ago. They couldn't afford bunkers of their own.
Well, we'll see. I mean, we haven't gotten into anything yet, but this particular place, as much as, I mean, there's issues about, I mean, just in general, I think about building doomsday bunkers, especially luxury ones, considering maybe you could use the money to fend off doomsday, but, we'll get there when we get there. But as a concept and like the way the place seems is set up, it seems fairly like well thought out, I think, but we'll decide as we,
I just like to talk shit.
I know. So I am inside the most lavish and sophisticated private bunker in the world, the Survival Condo. It sounds so like hardcore, like yet suburban or something. Like
to me, it sounds like a game show.
The Survival Condo. It's like, yeah, like a, yeah, like a dystopian game show, like Running Man or something.
Yeah, something like Survivor mixed with Fear Factory. Is that the name of that stupid show?
No.
Fear Factory. Though. Fear Factor? Yeah. Fear Factory was like
that's a band, I think.
Yeah, they were like a industrial metal band, I remember now. It's all coming back together.
Fear Factor with the Joe Rogan Experience before the Joe Rogan Experience.
Yes, that's where he taught all of America how to eat cockroaches.
Yes. So the Survival Condo. It was once a Cold War U.S. government missile silo, constructed in the early 60s at a cost of approximately $15 million to the U.S. taxpayer. It was one of 72 structures built to protect a nuclear warhead 100 times more powerful than the bomb dropped on Nagasaki. Many of these silos were blown up and buried after decades of disuse, but not all of them. One silo in Wamego, Kansas, was raided by police in 2000 when they discovered a giant LSD production facility inside.
It's one of the worst things to ever happen in America.
I remember this. I remember this story when it happened in real time as well.
Me too.
Which was
one of the worst things to ever happen in America.
Well, let's finish the sentence. Explain exactly why. Because this place was generating up to a third of the country's supply of LSD.
America was a better place.
Another silo near Roswell, New Mexico, had been turned into an extraterrestrial communication facility. Oh, that's worth the money. which flashed binary code via laser beams into the cosmos. A third silo was funded by William Shatner. This article is so dumb. It like goes on to explain that William Shatner is also known as Captain James T. Kirk of Star Trek.
He's the guy that has the really great album.
Mm-hmm. Common People, etc.
Yeah, he sings really well.
William Shatner Kirk bought a silo to become a commercial research facility for studying the viability of colonizing Mars. What the hell? William Shatner is just like a proto Elon Musk. Yet another silo.
William Shatner is so much more than Elon Musk.
Yeah, but they're both just like Mars nerds. Yet another silo in Abilene, Texas, is now a scuba diving training facility. Out of all of those, I mean, obviously the LSD one's the best. The scuba diving one seems cool. I don't know what's more of a waste of money, the Mars colonizing research one or the flashing binary code out to the sky one.
I mean, they had to buy these research, these bunkers back from the U.S. government, right?
Yeah. But they're like, I mean, they're marked down quite a bit. But still, yeah, they bought because they were just going to get rid of them. And so, yeah, people were buying them and doing little pet projects, including this guy here, Larry Hall.
Why didn't they use the other ones for housing?
Like public housing, not for the ultra wealthy.
Yeah, but I was just picturing this like program where like we're gonna give all the needy homes, they're just gonna be underground, out of sight.
I mean, it'd be better than not having a home or having a shitty home. And there's like tons of these missile silos still, I think. Continuing, of all the projects that blossomed in the spaces vacated by the state, Hall's is arguably the most gobsmacking. You can tell this is written by a Brit. As an ex-government contractor, property developer, and doomsday prepper with a master's degree in business, he had the perfect amalgam of attributes to build what had never been done before. In the 1990s, he worked for a private defense contractor designing the weapons database for an Air Force surveillance plane. Later, he moved into constructing hardened data centers. What does that even mean? Anyway.
Like servers?
I guess that's all I can imagine. Like servers, you mean? First, he had planned to build one in a silo, but he quickly realized there was another emerging market. In doomsday prepping for the super rich. So that's like another thing I want to touch on in discussing this subject is just how like there's this subculture of prepping. There's this trend of the wealthy, like seeing the writing on the wall and building their little hideout shelters,
castles.
But also it's like, people are seeing that, yeah, there's a market for it as well. Like, even for like maybe the more upper middle class, not necessarily the ultra wealthy.
But also want a ticket on the Snowpiercer.
Something like that. Yeah. So, okay, here we go. Hall bought the $15 million silo in 2008 for $300,000. See, it's like really reduced price. But I mean, when he bought it, I mean, it literally was, it's basically just, it's a hole in the ground where a missile used to be. So when I was watching that show, which I'm going to mention a little more later on, but like the Doomsday Preppers show, part of one of the episodes, it shows his bunker, but it was back in like 2011 or 2012. When it was just
before he'd like built it at all, remodeled,
it was just completely empty. Yeah, and like it's him walking around like really excitedly, like saying like we're gonna have this here and that here, and it is, I mean, you know, whatever, we're gonna like sort of pass more judgment or not or whatever on this whole thing, but like I was sort of like amused to see like the before and after. Separately, like seeing, because like I could imagine watching that back when it was on, like, you know, almost 10 years ago, and being like, oh, this guy's a lunatic, like he's never gonna build all this shit, because then he's like saying there's gonna be a swimming pool and a movie theater and a hyper fast elevator and all this stuff, and that's all of the stuff he said like came true. But then again, you know, it's just a matter of money, time and money. So in any case, he bought this the missile silo for $300,000. By 2010, he had transformed the 60 meter deep building into a 15 story luxury bolt hole. I never heard that word before. It just sounds like dirty.
It does sound a little bolt dirty.
Bolt hole. Where up to 75 people could weather 5 years inside the sealed, self-sufficient bunker. So yeah,
where do they get their time frames from? They bring that up a lot in the show you told me to watch.
Yeah, Doomsday Preppers. They they have supposed experts. once you get into the second season as well, they get even more specific about that, and they give a more specific numeric like rating on each person's like doomsday preparation Great. Plan, and they'll be like you, and like they're pretty harsh too. They're like, I've never seen them give anybody like barely over like 50 out of 100 score, and they'll say like, according to our estimates, you know, whatever that really means, I guess, that like your initial survival time would be like 4 months or 18 months or something like that. So, I mean, I think we'll get into a little more detail though of where he gets the 5 year number from. But yeah, so this thing can apparently contain 75 people max for 5 years, but like without having to leave at all for any sort of supplies. It goes on to say, Hall knew there would be takers. He had heard about the Silicon Valley elite burying bunkers on ranches in New Zealand, which is what we were talking about briefly. Wealthy Russian oligarchs buying whole Pacific islands to escape to. I heard about that before. And bunkers being subcontracted by the wealthy. Notable examples include Bill Gates and Kim Kardashian. According to a Wired magazine article from 2007, Tom Cruise was planning to pour $10 million into building a bunker under his 298-acre estate in Telluride, Colorado.
298 acres, that's big.
It's Tom Cruise.
It's Tom Cruise. He's not a probably big most.
So it's just like even more of a magical, wide open wonderland.
Some other people.
I think like his only like terrestrial joy in life is riding motorcycles. It's what I gather from what I know about Tom Cruise.
I think he likes jumping out of helicopters and preaching the word of science.
Yes, yeah, science. That's what that is.
What is the name of the Scientology god?
Oh, Xenu? He's not a god. Like Zine is the foil, the bad galactic creature. There's not really a god. Oh. Like you are god in Scientology. It's all about like the individual like overcoming their limits and shit.
So I hope Tom has a shrine room in the bunker he's going to build for himself.
Probably, but there's a bunch of weird shit in that bunker if it exists yet.
I always hear he's like a really nice guy.
He gives me the creeps though, really. He's too nice. Probably it's like creepy kind of nice, maybe. But who knows? And in Los Angeles, a porn production studio even decided to build their new headquarters in an underground bomb shelter. You know, just in case. And here we scroll by a picture of like a sort of a game room, looks like, with a rock climbing wall.
A ping pong table.
Yeah. Ping pong table. Played ping pong for 5 years straight.
Sounds like a good time, actually.
I'll tell you, man, by the time I got to the end of this article, I was kind of like, if I had enough money, maybe I'd get one of these apartments. And just live there, while everything's still functioning in society. Just move in there.
Just close it off for 5 years. Just be like, I'm going to take a 5-year vacation from society.
Well,
no internet, no nothing. Just me, the bunker, and my friends. We're staying here for 5 years. I'm rich now. I'm paying you. We'll re-enter the world 5 years later and see what it's like, knowing nothing about the outside.
Well, we'll get to some of the prices in a second, but it's like, You basically buy an apartment and there's like three different options basically. And the cheapest is
the cheapest is like a million.
And then you have to pay like a sort of like monthly fee of like $5,000, which is basically like for like, I don't know, upkeep or whatever. Which like, I don't know. I feel like some people that are considered upper middle class could afford that, but maybe not. I don't know. I think they could. Because like, that's the other thing about that show, the Doomsday Preppers show, is so many of these people, like, they don't seem rich, but I don't know, like, they seem to have all this money for all of this fucking crazy shit, like building bunkers in their backyards and like moving to Costa Rica, like, suddenly because they think, you know, they have a better chance of surviving the apocalypse there.
You know, it's a little known fact, but people born between the 1950s to 1960s made a lot of money doing nothing.
Yeah, but I'm talking about, like, some of the ones I'm thinking of, like, in particular are, like, people that are probably, like, on the young end of like Gen X generation. I'm going to just sum up this next paragraph. Like they mention how Trump hid in a bunker when there was like unrest outside the White House. I mean, that's kind of like a weird, like loosely connected story to this one, but then it mentions that Mar-a-Lago has a bunker as well. And yeah, Trump said back in 2007 he'd spent $100,000 fixing up the bunker. So lavish bunkers such as these are built not so much in response to a single imminent catastrophe, but out of a more general disquiet about a variety of threats. Preppers dread nuclear war and accidents, a collapsing ecosystem, runaway technology, pandemics, natural disasters, economic meltdown, and violence. Waiting out these disasters may require a few years. It's not that difficult to imagine living underground for a short-term lock-in. What's more of a challenge is to create a psychologically tolerable environment for the long haul, in order, not to put too fine a point on it, that the members of this newly troglodytic community don't murder each other. Okay, so on the topic of like people's mental health, like living underground, there's some interesting like case studies in this kind of stuff, and we'll kind of just breeze past a few of them here. But During the early days of the Cold War, governments, the military, and universities conducted numerous experiments to see how long people could withstand being trapped underground together. In total, in the early 60s, about 7,000 people volunteered to be locked in spaces with groups ranging from the size of a family to more than 1,000 people. As part of the U.S. government's attempts to assess the psychological impact. In one study, researchers locked groups of men, women, and children aged between 3 and 70 in fallout shelters six times between 1962 and 1964 for varying periods, during which they had to subsist on bulgur wheat, crackers, and water. They had no bathing water.
Jesus.
Hmm?
These conditions sound fucking
bad.
Yeah,
that's why I'm laughing, because it's like, of course you can guess what's going to happen next. They had no bathing water, bunks, or blankets. The researchers found, quote, that no deleterious psychological or social effects occur from two-week periods of group confinement under austere conditions.
Oh, it's just... Oh, okay. I misread that. See, I saw where it said between 1962 and 1964.
Oh, no. They were...
and totally glanced over the varying periods. And then I'm like, wait, was it 2 weeks or 2 years? It was like, they lived like that for 2 years and there were no... Okay, two weeks, yeah. I mean,
but 2 weeks isn't true. That long, and 2 weeks, like, given the apocalyptic scenario, it could be way longer than 2 weeks. And I mean, this survival condo, you know, they're talking about, like, you know, a max of 5 years without having to leave. But it seemed people could adapt. Just so long as they knew the situation was temporary. See, I think that's probably key. It's like, okay, this is just a study. This isn't real. So, like, you'd have to, like, account for, like, the stress of, like, let's say one of the worst case scenarios, total, like, nuclear annihilation, like nuclear, like a world war with nukes. And you knew what was going on, and you knew why you were never, you knew why you needed to hide in this, underground area. I mean, I think you probably wouldn't be in tip-top shape psychologically, but so the study suggested that when citizens needed to hunker down, the preparation required was less important than the need to, quote, prepare them for immediate adjustment to the post-attack world upon emergence. Then there's another survey that basically concluded the opposite, saying that there are all these negative effects of living underground, just like, you know, depression, difficulties concentrating, personality disturbances, and so on. And also that, like, these psychological disturbances would, like, almost sort of contagiously, like, pass through the, you know, population that was living together. So, Larry Hall.
I imagine too that so much of this would depend on who you were in the bunker with.
Yeah, I think that's another fact.
Do you know them and stuff? Like, I imagine this article is going to get to it. But, like, if you live in this guy's wealth bunker, do they have to go to meetings and stuff so they get to know each other a bit so that they, like, build an actual community?
There's a community aspect to it. So, contrary to those, like, negative studies, Larry Hall, however, thinks he has worked out a solution to these potential obstacles. The key to well-being underground, he tells me, could be about creating an illusion of normal life. So, we'll have people baking bread and making coffee. People can advertise their yoga class on the cafe blackboard. And we're going to stack this deli case full of three different species of tilapia that are grown in the aquaponics facility next door. The nitrates from the fish droppings will fertilize soil for the plants in the FDA-certified aquaponics facility. There's a whole thing about aquaponics on... Doomsday Preppers as well. It was like two next door neighbors who both were prepper types who were obsessed with aquaponics, which was something I didn't really know anything about. It's kind of interesting, actually. It's like, it's a way of growing produce, like, by, but you don't need, like, soil per se, I guess. Like, it just is grown, like, out of the water that the fish live in, and, like, their shit is the magical ingredient to make plants grow.
What do you do for sunlight? I guess sunlight, you just use, like, UV lights.
Oh, well, those guys weren't in bunkers, but yeah, I mean... There's a picture of it right below here. It looks like, they just have like.
Is it similar to how they grow stuff on spaceships in special plastic bags?
Maybe. I don't think they bring fish up to space, though, for that. He goes on to write, "The fresh produce from here will end up in the general store. Leftover vegetable matter, fish heads, and bones will be put through a grinder to become food for the residents' dogs and cats. So there's going to be pets here. Including
you can eat those for yourself.
Including Lollipop, Hall's cat, who's happily roaming around the silo four stories above us. It's critical.
I think the cats will get depressed too.
Yeah, well, probably not. I mean, cats are
maybe
cats
they're already are, depressed.
Cats are pretty like well adapted to just like living indoors. It seems.
That's true.
It's critical that we encourage people to come down, and they probably have more like roaming area than like in a regular size house. Anyway, it's critical that we encourage people to come down and shop and be social. So that sort of is getting at your question about like interacting with other people, because obviously everything in here is already paid for. So you're just like pretending to buy stuff at the store, which is kind of funny. Which is why this writer, the first thing they did was laugh out loud when they saw the kind of fake grocery store facade thing. Here's the money, the facts about the money, what it costs to live here. Money, in other words, will have no value in the survival condo. See, I don't think that's true. Still. I mean, I get what they're saying. Like, they've paid in advance for, like, the use of a lot of the stuff.
They paid different rates.
Well, but it's because just get to it here. For a half-floor apartment, okay, so you don't get the whole, like, circular
floor. To yourself.
It's 360 square feet, and it's $4.5 million. Oh, no, sorry. $1.5 million. For the full floor, it's $3 million. And then for two level, so like two whole floors, you pay $4.5 million. In total, 57 people will be living in 12 apartments, each paying an additional $5,000 a month in residence association fees. So it is like truly like a condo. Like, I think they like even like vote on stuff. I don't know. One apartment bought with cash is designed to feel like a log cabin with a loft looking down on a fake fireplace flanked by a 6-screen display of a snow-capped mountain range. This is the stuff I find kind of like weirdly fascinating, is like all of the illusory stuff with like screens and shit. There's more of it too. I mean,
This is like the more Luddite version of what Elon Musk wants to go to Mars for.
What do you mean? Like, it's just not as high tech as what his plans for Mars?
I mean, I feel like most of the reason that someone like Musk wants to go to Mars, other than just like public branding and getting more grant money for his companies, is because he's also a doomsday person, or just like a lot of people who want to go to Mars. It's more of like, one day humans have to figure out how to get out there. May as well learn how to live on spaceships now.
I think with Elon Musk, it's also just that he's like an egomaniac who like wants to be like, he wants to like have a legacy as like the man who got humanity to Mars.
Yeah, I think there's some of that
too.
Because
I think he could easily build like one of the, and he probably already does have like some giant fucking underground bunker somewhere. Be kind of surprised if he didn't.
I guess you can have both.
The writer goes on to mention that nobody that has bought these apartments is actually on site the day that they're there. It's which I guess makes sense. They're these rich people, like, And there's no disaster, so they probably just don't come to hang out in the bunker. They probably have big mansions above ground for the time being.
I can't imagine paying over $1 million for something, quite literally, and then paying $5,000 in rent forever, I guess. They're paying $5,000 in rent forever. Until, you know, civilization burns down in a fiery house from the bombs.
Yeah, I mean, indefinitely, right? Yeah, I guess, yeah.
I guess this guy's made his money back. Has he sold all the apartments already?
It appears maybe, although I'm not really sure. Wait, yeah. I don't know. There's like a map of how many floors there are, but I can't really look at it right now. But
I was actually a little confused about that because like,
it says that they could fit 75 people, and right there it said 57 are planning to be there at the moment in 12 apartments. So maybe they can. Well, he's definitely made his money back, even if he sold just one. Because, well, actually, take that back.
I think there's 14 floors looking at this map.
He paid $300,000 for the hole in the ground, but I'm sure he spent millions and millions to like deck out this place. I'm just going to kind of like fly by a couple of things here. Like the bunkers are being used not just for like hiding out during the end times, but like the U.S. Library of Congress has made is putting a lot of stuff into a bunker as a way of avoiding the fate of like the Library of Alexandria burning, to like preserve all of this wonderful culture. So they continue their tour on level 11 of the survival condo, about 50 meters underground. Hall and I visit an 1800 foot square foot home. I've had the same feeling as walking into a bedroom in a hotel chain. The apartment has never been used. It has a Navajo print rug, cushy white sofa set, and some stone electric fireplace with a flat panel TV over it. A marble countertop extends to a bar separating the living room from the kitchen, which is filled with high-end appliances. I look at one of the windows and I'm shocked to see it's dark outside. My instant physiological reaction is to assume we must have been underground for longer than I thought. Then I realize my mistake. Got you, Hall says, laughing. He picks up a remote control and flicks on a video feed being piped into the, quote, window, a vertically installed LED screen. The scene depicted is the view from the front at the surface level entrance of the condo. It is daytime, breezy and green outside. I could see my car through the branches of an oak tree, exactly where I'd parked it a few hours earlier. But when this video was made is not necessarily obvious. Maybe there's a time lapse and I'm watching a pre-recorded past I'm convinced is the present. The thought sends a prickle of unease down my spine. After lockdown, Hal could choose precisely which material to share with the other occupants. Their sense of context, of reality, of what's happening above ground, whether or not the world has ended, is entirely in his grip. Most people prefer to know what time of day it is than to see a beach in San Francisco, though, he says, casually flicking off the feed again. The screen goes blank. So I thought, I just kind of liked the imagery of that weird sort of I don't know, disorienting moment that this journalist has with this weird guy who just is like, yeah, I control all the screens in this place.
But will he still control them all when everyone moves in, I guess?
I mean, the person is making kind of a sort of a leap in guessing that he would. But I mean, I guess technically, like, if these screens are just like being controlled in some like main hub somewhere else, that like the person, but I'm sure the person in the apartment can like, personalize.
I'm sure you
what
have
they
control
want.
Of the yeah, screens yeah. in your apartments. There might be like some master system though, where they like throw out PSAs or whatever.
I just think it's interesting that this writer, like, I think in a matter of like maybe a few hours at the most, I'm guessing, was already starting to like get kind of weird and paranoid by being underground for just a little bit. And I mean, I saw the video of this guy. He does seem like sort of like a big, friendly kind of guy. I don't know, but maybe there's something like sinister about him as well. I don't like the fact that he like seems to be like CIA connected or whatever, or some sort of government contractor. But I don't know. They get into this thing a little later. The writer that suggests maybe this is actually it's right here. Here, I'll just read it. Hall is not just experimenting with new technology. He's thinking about how to control people's thoughts and reactions. I know he was once a, quote, spook and worked as a government contractor. I wonder if this whole thing has actually been funded by the Department of Defense as a human petri dish, the next iteration of those 1960s Cold War human experiments. Not telling the residents they are partaking in an experiment would be the key to its rigor. So maybe this is another government experiment. I'd kind of doubt it.
A blind test of rich people living underground. Why not?
I don't think they do that shit to rich people, number one. And number two, I don't think anybody's interested in that kind of stuff anymore, honestly. Like in the 60s, it was all like novel and it was like, look at all this excess money we have to do just like any kind of weird social experiments we want, you know, like in all the universities. I just feel like that kind of stuff doesn't happen nearly as much anymore these days. But who knows?
A lot of research is still done, but it's just done with like data and surveillance, which is much easier to,
I mean,
just use surveillance for.
I just think that the psychological effects of isolation are already like pretty well known. Like, I don't think this would be like useful to any government agency. Also, nobody's fucking living in this place.
Unless the government agency is like getting ready to just have a site for when the world does end soon. Maybe they know when it's going to end. Like that great British TV show Utopia, where they plan to kill off like 75% of the world population, but they have like special bunkers for all the rich people.
I mean, I don't doubt that there are special bunkers for like all the rich people, and that's one of the more interesting things I saw on that Doomsday Preppers show. Was one guy was just kind of like making the point of like, people think we're, you know, the prepper community is like a bunch of weirdos and crazy people, like, or we're paranoid, but all of the rich people, all of the like these politicians, you know, and I mean, he's just like going by instinct, but he's like, they prep, like they just don't do it publicly. So why shouldn't you, you know, why don't you also look out for yourself like these fuckers do? It's kind of his point.
Well, those are like the same people who tell you to follow the exact same financial advice as rich people, who are like, you're just not doing well in life unless you have 6 months of your pay saved up, which I've never successfully saved up 6 months of my pay because I suck as a human. But apparently, at least that's what I've been led to believe.
Well, I think
retirement funds, that just seems impossible. I get what they're saying, though. I think they're saying if they're preparing for this and they, being rich and the nature of being connected, know more than us. And if they feel like they need to prepare, we probably need to prepare too.
Yeah. And I mean, he was also just saying like, you shouldn't feel marginalized because these people that like the world looks up to some degree or another, like they're all preparing for the shit to hit the fan or whatever. But, so there's a little bit more about like this sort of like, trying to keep people sane in this place, which I find kind of interesting. But Hall explains that he lived in the bunker for a month before the window system was installed. The window system being like all these screens that look like
the screens.
Yeah, look like windows to whatever sort of views you want to see. It was, he says,
does he have
like
an apocalypse view? Huh? Like a nice apocalyptic view where it shows like a famous scene from, I don't know, like the Terminator 2, Sarah Connor, like flashback or something.
Just on a loop, that shot of her like melting against the fucking fence of the playground. Yeah, that's what I would want to look at.
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one I would play constantly in my bunker.
I don't know why I just thought, I think I just thought of it because the word casino is like right in the sentence I'm about to read, but I just pictured the scene where Joe Pesci's getting like horribly beaten to death in the cornfield just on a loop on the screen. Dominic! Dominic! Watching his brother die.
The other people in the complex like, can't go to Josh's house. He freaks us out. His windows are real weird.
He's got this Terminator casino gift thing on a loop for some reason. He's a real fucked up guy. So Larry Hall says that living in the bunker for a month, it's not specified if he was completely alone or not. But anyway, he said without the window system, as he calls it. He said it was like living in a casino. Unable to confirm that the passing of time correlated to what his clocks were telling him or who was coming or going outside of the bunker, he felt totally isolated. The LED screens changed all of this by reintroducing a circadian rhythm. I mean, that makes sense. It also just has this sort of creepy feeling to me as well, though, of just like the artificiality of screens. I don't know. Something about it is unsettling. Yeah. But I mean, I guess it's probably better than not having it, honestly.
I know it's like become common for people to have like smarter lights and shit that like work on timers so your light turns on at the time you'd want your alarm to turn on to help you like wake up and stuff. And I imagine just doing lighting systems and ways on timers would solve some of that.
Yeah,
too. But I think the screen. He gets in any of that type of illusion stuff.
He gets into that as well, like and how like the psychologists like recommended like certain tones of lighting or whatever that subconsciously change people's moods, which I totally get. Lighting really. Gives me the makes my skin crawl in a weird way. Is that weird?
I love the. You don't love the buzzing fluorescent office light?
No, it kind of makes me feel sick even just thinking about it right now.
Buzz, kind of flickers occasionally because one of them needs to be changed.
I don't want to go on a whole light thing here, but there's like two lights in my apartment that like I just it makes me like. Like wince when they get turned on. It's like almost an ongoing joke between Haewon and I, where like she'll turn it on because she really wants to see stuff. Ooh la di da! I want to see things that are around me.
While
I'm content with like fairly low lamp light. I just feel much more at ease with that. But when like the big bright sort of. Ceiling fluorescent type light comes on. It almost makes me feel like sick. Maybe I'm just insane now.
You're not the only person I know like that. I use my fluorescent lights more than I probably should because I also have them. But like Yane hates fluorescent lights. First thing, she's like a lamp person. And I think a lot of people I know are lamp people.
I'm a total lamp person. My first apartment in Korea, like it had just, there was no way to like selectively turn on just one or two. And they were just like, there's these long fucking fluorescent lights on the ceiling. So if I wanted to see anything, I had to have them on. This is before I had like furniture of any kind. But then when I finally bought just like a cheap, tiny little lamp, it was like revolutionized. Like I was like comfortable to stay in my apartment for more than like 30 minutes at a time. So I'm just trying to say lighting is, it's real, folks. It has real effect.
I only like candlelight and oil lamps.
Lamps in general.
Oil lamps.
Okay, they must be made with oil, whale blubber.
Real fire. Like grandfather did.
I'm not going to go into like my neuroses about candles.
You have a problem with
not
candles?
Not really, but just sometimes I think about them just burning my house down and I blow them out. And it's like an ongoing battle of how things are lit in the house. Anyway, Jesus Christ, we cannot stay on topic.
Okay.
Yeah, it's fine, whatever.
It's fine.
Circadian rhythm, that's the last thing I saw. One of the survival condo's residents, the one with the two-story penthouse, has bought into this idea. She has filmed Central Park from her Manhattan loft during all four seasons, day and night, together with the cacophonous sounds of urban life. To accommodate this year-round record on video, Hall and the maintenance man ground down the cement wall of the silo and slathered it with reflective paint. Then they bought a balcony with a railing and, using a $75,000 throw projector, made it appear as if the resident could step onto the balcony to look over the city through sliding glass doors. That's kind of wild. I wish they had a picture of that. I don't think they do. Nope. The psychologist drilled into me that my job is to make this place as normal as possible, Hall says. No one wants to be reminded all the time that they are basically living in a submarine. Come on, I'll show you the life support system. Then they go on to...
Why is it underwater?
Huh?
Why haven't they built one of these underwater?
There probably is. Okay, they probably have. I feel like if it... Yeah. There was an episode of the show, the Prepper show. Then in the description, it had somebody who had built survival boat type situation, and I really wanted to see it, but for some reason it wasn't playing.
Like a survival yacht or
something like that. So yeah, maybe I'll find a submarine one or something, or
maybe it has a submarine, like a submarine inside the yacht, the yacht's like the battle station with a submarine that you sometimes have to get into to go do submarine stuff at the end of the world.
I mean, I feel like you'd be maybe more better off in a sort of like a there's, you know, violent gangs roaming around all fighting each other for resources if you could get out to the ocean. But then again, I don't know, a lot of more dangers there.
I mean, one of my favorite sections of the Earth Remembrance books, which I highly recommend anytime I think of them. There's some like doomsday stuff in that. And I think some preppers end up, in fact, I know some preppers end up living in that series after Earth had been destroyed. And the only other Earthlings that lived were like some Navy people that got stuck in a submarine, but somehow the two tribes get connected like hundreds of years later. And they've like, there's been enough time to where like, the way they've learned to live in the aftermath of like apocalypse has changed them enough to where they don't really relate to each other as like the same species anymore. Like, I mean, obviously they're humans, but they're like removed enough at that point where like one had been going on living basically in this like submarine for however many years, and the others have been like in a bunker like society. It's interesting.
That is one more reason to check out those books. Let's see here. So he shows the writer like how they can have like self-sustaining like water supply, which is, you know, it's just sort of a technical speak, but it looks like it's pretty solid way of being able to live for 5 years at least water wise. Then we move down to level 3, where Hall keys a code into a thick steel door. He opens it to reveal something like the scene from The Matrix, in which Neo and Trinity zap into the boundless arsenal to choose their wares. This is one of the 3 armories, Hall announces proudly. In each one, we've got sniper rifles, ARs, helmets, gas masks, first aid kits, and non-lethal weapons such as military-grade pepper spray. It wouldn't be a bunker without a...
Military weapons
stored away.
What couldn't that lead to like worse problems? you know, when they're all like trapped down there.
Yeah, people lose their mind, which I mean, I guess is like why he's emphasizing the, you know, having the psychologist like consult on the whole thing. I think also that like there's a ton of weird security stuff, which is actually just coming up right here. Like basically like, yeah, like AI, like 2001, like shit.
Oh, like how 2000. That's cool.
Where like maybe if someone goes insane, like it just like, it just like locks them into a section of the bunker where they can't hurt anybody.
Bunker.
But also you could see, you could totally imagine that kind of shit malfunctioning. But,
I mean, I'm just imagining Boston Dynamic robots running through the bunker and grabbing you and pinning you down.
Those terrifying and, headless dog robots. Jesus. And
pulling your arms behind you in like a submission hold, speechless, fast, silent Boston Dynamics. This guy can afford them.
He actually he goes on to downplay the need for guns actually here, but then goes on to play up how they... Well, I'll just read it. But, he continues, the armories might not even be needed. Outside is a .223 remote-controlled rifle. You can kill people like it's a video game. Hall opens up another key-coded bulletproof door to reveal a massive bank of screens and a control panel with a joystick. He explains that although they have thermal, night, and full-spectrum cameras inside and outside the entire facility... The rifle can be put into an automated defense mode, firing 3-round bursts at anything that comes into its field of view. So they've got a, like a robot gun protecting the outside of the perimeter of the place.
You know, it's cool that just non-military people can buy that.
I mean, he is kind of a military guy. He's like a he was some sort of contractor or some shit.
And if I don't know if the law applies for ex-CIA, but I know like law enforcement agents, like cops at least, even after they're retired, are allowed to carry guns no matter what.
Yeah, that sounds right. Not morally correct, just right. He goes on to say, we can also hit them with 3-round bursts of paintballs.
Oh, good.
As a, like a warning shot. The joystick is part of a larger multi-screen control panel called Kaleidoscope, a basic AI system capable of closing off parts of the bunker automatically in the event of, say, a fire. Or, like I was saying, someone losing their mind and trying to kill everybody, maybe? If that puts you in the mind of 2001 A Space Odyssey and the possibility that Kaleidoscope could start trapping people and hitting them with 3-round bursts, you're right in sync with me at this point. Hall pauses and takes a deep breath. Look, he says, the fact is, this was not a space of hope. The defensive capability of this structure existed only to the extent that it was needed to protect a missile. This bunker was a weapon system. We have converted a weapon of mass destruction into the opposite. This is a safe, self-contained, sustainable experiment in architecture. It's a subterranean equivalent of the University of Arizona's Biosphere project. So he's got a pretty rosy, optimistic view of... I keep forgetting the name of it. Survival Condo. Then it goes on to talk about this Biosphere 2, I guess it was called. This another scientific...
Yeah, that's what Biodome was based on.
That's what I figured. That's what made me think of Biodome. So they had 4 men and 4 women... Yeah, living in a glass dome and growing food, and then they were like running out of food and like oxygen levels were going down, and it sounds like a nightmare. It also mentions some linking us to what we're going to talk about next week or next episode rather. It says Biosphere 2 taught us a lot about how humans act under extreme pressure. Paradoxically, for a project in ecological sustainability, it was funded by oil money. Didn't know that. And here's the part I was talking
about that either.
It was also taken over before the second mission by Steve Bannon, Trump's former chief strategist, who carried around a copy of The Fourth Turning, a book by William Strauss and Neil Howe about apocalyptic rebirth.
Jeez.
So Steve Bannon enters the picture here. Yeah, this I think
I'm kind of surprised to see Steve Bannon enter the picture here.
I'd like to read more about, I think I'd heard about the biosphere experiment, probably just as like, did you know Biodome was based on a real thing? But I'd like to maybe go into that in more detail later. But
I feel like I read some like essay about it in university that was actually good, and I'd have to figure out the name of it. I want to say it was like a Harper's Magazine essay. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, and it sounds, you know, it's I imagine it's got similarities with like, say, like the Stanford prison experiments and stuff like that, where like you see how quickly people will like adapt in a bad way to like stressful situations, to put it lightly, I guess. Our tour continues. Like a burly Willy Wonka, Hall leads me past the climbing wall, air hockey and table tennis, and a pet park complete with artificial grass sandwiched between a fake tree and a sunny mural set in the Rocky Mountains. He opens a door and flips a light switch to illuminate a 50,000-gallon steel swimming pool flanked by a rock waterfall, lounge chairs, and a picnic table. A mural of a tropical beach is painted on the wall behind it. I saw a picture of that somewhere in a different article. And yeah, it's there's something weird about the artificial attempt to like make people's minds at ease. I don't know. I can't quite even explain why. It just, it kind of weirds me out in a way. I think after a while, it would stop working on you. Maybe that's what I'm trying to get at. Like, it would maybe even, like, exacerbate any kind of, like, mental problems you might be having. It's just like, this is a screen. This is a mural. Like, how can I keep, like, imagining that I'm, like, not in a hole in the ground? I mean, if you really had to live there for, like, 5 years or something.
I mean, that's why I would have Sarah Connor melting.
Yeah, that wouldn't mess with your mind at all. Just I think it would pleasant.
Work better than looking at fucking the Windows cloud behind me every day, because that's the background. The other background I would choose, just the Windows 95 perfect blue cloud.
Yeah, I guess I had to choose.
That's my childhood.
So there's also a, I'm almost done here, and they've got like a full like movie theater in the place as well. And it says that they're about to watch Skyfall. Larry Hall's
that's a James Bond
favorite
movie, right?
Of the 007 franchise. He shouts over the soundtrack that we are immersed in a 7.4 THX surround sound and a 4K video projection. After a few minutes of this, Hall ushers me into the adjoining aircraft-themed bar. One of the residents has donated 2,600 bottles of wine from her restaurant to stock it. I was started imagining like just people getting like fucking ripped all the time at this place.
2,600 wine bottles. If you generally drink, you know, 3 bottles of wine a night, like I like to do, you know, when I'm drinking. I'm currently not drinking that much. Let's say my average is 3. I don't think 3 lasts that long. I mean, 2,600.
No, it's not that much, really, especially, I mean, think 5 years. And I mean, I think there's probably more booze than just that. I think they're just saying like, hey, look, one of these rich people donated a bunch of wine as well.
How would they deal with a prolific drinker? God, I would just get thrown out. I would get locked off by the AI case.
Yeah, they just like keep you in your room and like keeps, it'd be like, I was going to say it'd be like Old Boy, but... In the remake of Old Boy, the fucking stupid Spike Lee remake, the thing that's different is when the character is locked in the room for the 15 years or 18 years, whatever it is. He's like, I mean, the original character is like a drunk as well, but in the new one, they keep him drunk while he's in there. Like with his food, they give him like a pint of vodka. And like most of the time, he's just drinking. I guess understandably, if you're in that.
Do they give him the same food every time?
I think so. Yeah. It's
like they do.
They do that. Like, it's like it's dumplings from like a Chinese restaurant around the corner or something. And that's how he figures out. I think that happens in the original too. Yeah. But yeah, the difference is he's like drunk for like half his time there, and then he stops drinking and like starts learning. Like,
they're drugging the guy in the original movie, though.
That is true, somehow. Right? Yeah. So maybe instead of just drugging, they're like, just give him vodka. He'll knock himself out with it, you know. But yeah. Anyway, how did we get on that? All right, the wine.
It's a great movie, man.
It is, and the remake is fucking stupid.
I'll never watch
it. It's kind of worth watching in a weird way. And once you get to the end, you're just like, oh, fuck this. Like, the ending is so much worse than... Anyway.
Happier, I imagine.
There's an epilogue. Not really. It's just... you're just feeling like, why? Why was this made? There's no reason for it. It's not even like it's particularly bad. It's just like, why? No reason for this. Hmm. So the writer ends the main part of the article, I should say, I guess. Here we go. This is where he goes on about the lighting, which you already talked about and gave a lot of anecdotes about, how it's a key to surviving. Is like, oh, he also wants to dispel this idea of like, people are like, why does it have to be luxurious? Like this place. And he says it's not about luxury. It's about survival. Like if you don't have like the right lighting and stuff, people will like... He just says depression and cabin fever, but like, yeah, you could go totally psychotic, I think, in that situation, even with the luxury stuff. But Hall expands on this, his theme. In fact, everyone needs to work, generally. People on vacation constantly get destructive tendencies. That's just human nature. You have to have a 4-hour minimum work day and rotate jobs so people don't get bored and break things. This guy's a weird way of speaking that I kind of like, actually. In building these spaces, there's an implicit assumption. This is the writer again. There's an implicit assumption that we have given up on fixing the world we broke. You might imagine the resources invested in building these underground redoubts. What the fuck is a redoubt?
I think it's another word for a bunker.
Stupid British bullshit.
Stupid British word.
Take it again. You might imagine the resources invented in building these underground bunkers might be better spent trying to address the catalysts for disaster. But this is why we should pay attention to private bunkers. They are a reflection of how deeply our dread has saturated us. The tour over, we head back to the surface. Only after a few hours in that hermetically sealed environment, the warm sun on my face and the smell of the trees and the grass give me an overwhelming sense of having walked into a painting animated through some mysterious force.
I do think this writer is going a bit exaggerated on like how bad it was to be down in the bunker, like with his uncomfortable feelings and stuff, which I'm fine with. I like the exaggeration. I would probably do the same thing, but...
Come I on, think so too. Like, I think it's just, you know, they're trying to like spice up the article or something. But I think yeah, those are good sure. points though, also at the end about like how you could imagine the money being spent on fixing the broken world instead of just like hiding from the problems. Which I think
yeah,
is
I
like,
mean, it seems like a lot of the people that can afford these places are the very people that have created a lot of the problems
I'm
by saying
sure, yeah. I'm sure.
By saying, no, we will not stop using fossil fuels, or no, we're not going to recycle now, or no, we're not going to follow these emission codes. There's profit to be made. Let the next generation deal with that shit.
Yeah. And I also like how the reason we should pay attention to this stuff is how it's a reflection of sort of just like the dread and anxiety, like that's kind of...
In society.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, it got me thinking, like, is there, like, more of these bunkers being made now than there were during, like, say, the Cold War? Or when I know there was, like, another time in U.S. history that people were, like, maybe not building as lavish bunkers, but, like, there was, like, a phenom of people building, like, bomb shelters.
Yeah,
right, during, like,
I think,
the Cold War?
I think during, like, the probably 60s, 50s and 60s, but they were probably, I think those were, like... It's like the Simpsons episode where Flanders has a bomb shelter and it's like, you know, it's just like a cement like box, like
which is what I think of as a bomb shelter usually, but I
Well, it is. I'm just saying, like, this is like a whole another level. And like the other thing is now is they're like being commercialized. Like you can buy these like bunkers that are just these huge, you know, thick steel things, and they just bury it in your backyard for, you know, I forget how much money they cost, but like there are like
some reason it being commercialized bothers me to no end.
Yeah, it's weird, but I mean there's where there's a demand, you know, supply will sweep in.
It gives me like, I mean, if I'm going to agree with the preppers you were talking about earlier, it does give me that like Chekhov's gun like vibe. It's like, oh, if we see the bunkers, that means the end is coming.
Mm, I see what you mean. Like the bunker has to be used before the play is over.
Yeah, exactly. The bunker is the gun.
Yeah. Could be. I mean, just one more thing about this article. I'm not going to read it, but the writer like tacks on this like epilogue postscript thing that's like, after writing this, like coronavirus hit the world and like huge wildfires destroyed like a billion animals in Australia. And then I got back from Australia to Los Angeles where the sky was like red from, you know, wildfires there. So like the point being, like they felt sort of like, oh, like maybe the last sentence is that the pandemic was precisely the kind of breakdown preppers were preparing for, which is something like you can't help but think about when you see these like, say 10-year-old episodes of the Doomsday Prepper shows, and it's people
it's
who
true,
are
but I
just, prepping specifically but head, for pandemics. And like people are laughing at them and shit. And I would have been laughing at them too, probably. Like one of them was like a suburban mom who was like really, really militant, like vigilant about just everything being like sanitized in the house, and like would do like drills, like making her whole family, including like her elderly parents who could like barely move, like put on like full bodysuit, hazmat suits, and like
not OCD at all.
Yeah, but then I thought about like, well, she probably was like, see, I told you so, motherfuckers, like when.
And you know what? Worst case scenario, all of this happened, and she's like, oh, that's just made up. This whole mask stuff is just made up. There's no reason to wear a mask.
Oh, I didn't even think about that, too.
As a politics thing.
Yeah, because, like, so kind of, like, easing from away from the luxury thing into, like, the more... So there are like other demographic groups that make up like this prepper world, and they're not necessarily like couldn't necessarily afford like one of these apartments in the
survival. Yeah, they're the ones
condo.
Who plan on living out the apocalypse on whatever's left of the surface.
Yeah, some of them do have bunkers, but they're like way smaller. Like one of the right. guys I saw on the show, he had like a family And I think he was probably like a Gen Xer, and I was kind of interested in like the generational aspect of it too, because like, anyway, before I get to that, like
Gen Xers, what? They were at the very end of the Cold War, so like they have some of that going on.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, I guess I was wondering, like, because you know, you'd expect like, okay, it's probably just a bunch of like boomers or even older. But like I think, and there definitely is that I've seen, and it's, you know, I haven't watched like the whole series. I probably watched maybe like, I don't know, 8 episodes or something in the last couple of days. But one thing I was a little surprised by, like, somewhat of a variety of types of people. At least that's what they try to do in the beginning. Like maybe as the show keeps going, it just becomes like sort of a repeat of the same sort of stereotype people. But like, for example, one of the people in the show was like a boomer age like dad with his living with like his son and two daughters, and they just had like kind of a modest size house in the suburbs, like next to like a major freeway. But their whole thing was like worrying about how genetically modified food is going to like destroy the entire food system, which is completely fringe theory. It doesn't really make any sense. But at the same time, they were like really harmless. They weren't like gun hoarders. Like their whole thing was just, we're growing our own food and we're preparing for like a time when you can't buy food from the grocery store anymore.
One of my favorite books that I think I recommended on the podcast is about Terminator seeds gone wrong, to where, I mean, generally GMOs are pretty good, but like this whole series was about how, like, what if they screw up and like one of the crops gets infected and like suddenly the crops just can't breed anymore and they're not making seeds.
Yeah. I mean, I guess maybe they're not so far off. I mean, what the guy said, I think I remember, was like, because like certain, you know, insects or worms or whatever were becoming like, we're building like a resistance to the crops, that like it was just actually creating like larger, more substantial insects that could do more damage. But
I haven't heard that. I know that like maybe they brought it up, but you know, as Earth gets warmer, and it is getting warmer, like, you know, Sydney reaching 48.9 Celsius, which is what, like 130 degrees, ballparking that number there. The hotter it is, the bigger insects will get, because the hotter it is, there's more oxygen, and that means insects can grow bigger and bigger. So as the Earth gets hotter, just expect bigger bugs.
I can't wait to see a mosquito the size of a basketball. You can just punch them. That would just be such a terror. I would probably just kill everywhere. Myself.
Oh, I would too.
Anyway, yeah, I mean, I went on a little bit of a marathon of some of these shows, and like I found some of it kind of interesting and some of it sort of illuminating about the way that like people are expressing real anxieties about, like, you know, socioeconomic, political, ethical dilemmas, and like even like religion plays into it in some of the examples. And but then I think that like sort of one of the problems is that the way they rationalize their actions is really divorced from reality. Like, so for example, one of the most common things you hear on the show is like people terrified of like economic collapse, which is like for other reasons than they give, like a thing to really worry about. But all they talk about is the national deficit, the national debt that's going to kill us. It's going to destroy the world. Which
makes no sense.
It doesn't make any sense. It's not connected to
reality.
I mean,
the moment you realize that money's made up, you should be fine.
Yeah, I remember kind of thinking like they just need to be aware of this MMT, modern monetary theory. But yeah, a lot of the stuff gets couched, and none of them specifically say like, I fucking hate Obama, but it's like kind of heavily implied. The other thing, like the historical context of the show, is that the whole thing ran from like 2011 or 2012 to, I think, 2014. So all like squarely in Obama's like second term, basically.
Yeah.
And like, so I guess also right around the time of like Occupy Wall Street, at least probably when it was winding down, and like the Arab Spring. And of course, like coming off of like the 2008 crash and like the bailouts and everything. But like, it's funny how
the foreclosures.
Yeah, and the foreclosures. Although, like most of these people, like I think we said earlier, like nobody is working class and a prepper. at least on this show. Maybe maybe
solidly middle class.
Yeah, these people have to have some excess money. Like nobody's living paycheck to paycheck. And then, because another thing about the show is the people, they estimate how much time they spend prepping, and like most of them are pretty obsessive about like stocking food or like looking at bunkers online or whatever.
Well, some of them are like growing their own food and stuff, but it also costs money to run a farm.
Yeah. I mean, I think the more sort of like hippie-ish family that I talked about, they're really an outlier though, like at least what I saw so far. And yeah, their main thing was just growing food in their like small yard, but they were like growing it like vertically, so they had like, you know, huge amounts of food or whatever. Yeah. And they were also like running their car off of like
biofuel of some sort,
frying oil or whatever.
peanut oil. I think I've heard of cars running off of peanut oil. I don't remember how to do that though.
They they would go and like they would trade like their fresh produce for like the, you know, the used oil at like a fast food place or whatever. I mean, I've heard of people doing that before too, but it's real hippie stuff. And, you know, Godspeed cool. with that for sure. So, okay, one other thing like I thought about while I was watching this show was how I was really like self-aware, like really keenly aware of like I don't want to fall into the automatic trap of just like kind of looking down on these people like a typical liberal, a smug liberal.
You know, it's illegal. It's illegal to run your car on vegetable oil. The Environmental Protection Agency has said that running cars on vegetable oil or converting cars to run on vegetable oil and selling vegetable oil for the use in cars are all illegal activities that are punishable.
I wonder what their reasoning is. That's funny because I'm pretty sure it has. Anyway. Yeah. It's like, what was that? There was that documentary, like who killed the electric car or whatever. And I always heard like anecdotally, like we had figured out a way to run like a car on like just water, just straight up H2O, like back in the '60s, but like the powers that be shut it down.
I'd heard something like that before too.
And I have no specifics to back that up. I remember always hearing about that, like in the background of whatever. But so with these doomsday preppers, I like very consciously was like trying to see things from their perspective, I guess. And like, yeah, just wanted to avoid like the typical kind of like, hey, look at these dumb, you know, lunatic Tea Party Rethuglicans, whatever people were saying in 2012. Because I think that was this show's success. I'm totally just guessing here, but I think a lot of it was like, I feel like I'd heard about this show in passing just as like, oh, do you watch those like, you know, crazy,
just a way
crazy
to look
preppers?
Down on
like, it's just like, hey, let's watch the stupid conservative idiots.
More hillbilly shaming.
Hillbilly shaming and just like kind of like, oh, they're dumb and like they're paranoid and they're conspiracy theorists. Which, I mean, all of those things are kind of true in a way. But like, also, their real fears are justified. They're putting it in a language and a rationalization that doesn't really make sense. Like, some of these people are terrified of like the poles flipping, like the magnetic poles of the earth flipping. They're convinced, you know, they don't say if it happens. They're always like, when the poles flip,
when
we gotta
happens.
Get ready. And like they think it's just going to cause like huge like global natural disaster catastrophe. One other thing about this show is that at the very, very end of each episode, they always kind of like basically
give them a score.
Well, even after the scoring thing, they're like, so by the way, this thing that these people are worried about is so unlikely to happen. See you next week.
Oh, yeah. I saw the one segment I watched, the guy was worried about a solar flare taking out like all a solar EMP.
Yeah.
And they're like, well, that does happen like every 150 years or something. But the type that would actually take out all the electronics in the world is every like 500 years.
Or they'll be like, scientists calculate that it's got like a 1 in a 20 million chance of happening anytime soon. Stuff like that. So like, yeah, I mean, what were some of the other big events? Like, people are really afraid of the super volcano in like somewhere like by like Yosemite, I think.
Yeah, the Yosemite, I think.
And
Yellowstone?
Yeah, over there. And I mean, historically, it's erupted and, like, caused huge damage. And, like, it would be kind of like that thing we talked about in some episode where back in, like, the year 500, whatever, when, like, the sun was just blotted out for, like, years. I guess that could happen, possibly. But, like, again, that was, like, counter.
That was from a volcano,
yeah.
Right?
There was one guy, I keep digressing. How does that happen? So one of the guys who was particularly worried about that, he was like, I think I would say he's the only like really working class person I've seen so far. I think he was a firefighter living in like a small apartment in New York with like his wife and kid.
I mean, he was also the only
non-white person I think that I've seen on the show. He was just really worried about the giant volcano, and he's living in New York, but he's like, you know, the ash can travel far enough. And so he was doing like drills, like to get to his like storage unit where he keeps like the extra food. But like those were the type of people that I'm like, I feel like even though like the thing they're worried about is probably pretty unlikely, like, I don't know. It's also not hurting anybody. He like puts on a gas mask and like walks to a storage unit to see if he can get there in 45 minutes, you know, to
good exercise.
Well, and the his motivations are like to save his family. And like that's what most of the people do say. There are like some outliers, like one of the guys who I had no real sympathy for, he was like a self-proclaimed inventor and he had like a huge mansion. But he lived there by himself just with like a dog. Oh, and he just had so much money for like who knows what, like, but he had like all this high tech crazy shit and he had like teams of people that were like training him how to like defend his house with guns and stuff. And that guy had no, like, it was nothing about like I'm protecting my family. It was just like, no, I want to keep the poor people away from my big house. So he was like practicing like how he could shoot through car doors and like get kill shots right away and stuff. But the funny thing was, he was big dorky looking guy who was just like cosplaying in his big mansion. But
I mean, all of this is fear motivated. People do weird irrational stuff when they get it in their head that like there's impending doom.
I agree. I think there's fear motivation. I think some of it though is that people actually like, they enjoy the process, they enjoy the sort of fantasy of like saving my family or like fending off the marauders. And
so it's like the same thing of people enjoying being part of Q. Like, I mean, just like the fantasy of life being bigger than it actually is.
Yeah, I can see there's like parallels. I thought about that myself too. I was like, I wonder how many of these people are like Q people now. Yeah. I mean, with the exception of a few people, I think most of these people were like sort of at the very least like conservative, probably like Tea Party adjacent, if not just outright. Probably a lot of them are like, you know, Trump people now. But yeah, there was just so much like talk about like, you'll take my gun from my cold dead hands. You know, the biggest problem that we're facing is the national debt. You know, nothing about like poverty. That's the other thing is like, you just can't help but think when you're like watching the show, like if these like events really happened, like my God, like anyone living paycheck to paycheck is fucked. And like, all this stuff is presented in a pretty classist way because they literally use words like roving bands of poor people and like marauders. They use the word marauder like a lot, which is weird to me because it just sounds so like, I almost feel like there's like a racial thing implied in it as well, considering that like all of the sort of protagonists are white people. I mean, maybe I'm reading a little too much into that, but I don't know.
I think you're reading too much into the word marauder. But
well, no, it's not just the word marauder. They're dehumanizing the people that would be desperate and like looking for food or water as like.
I mean, if it's just like economic collapse, maybe the poors, as they call them, will just all be very happy that all the rich ran underground and left the surface to us.
Yeah, but they're going to try to break into my bunker, which is why I got to have my Hell 9000 gun.
We just have to avoid the machine gun that shoots 3 rounds at a time.
Yeah, the Hell 9000 gun.
And be like, oh, the earth's so much better now that the rich fucks are gone.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it was just like a passing thought I had while I was watching like hours of this show yesterday. It's like a lot. I mean, a lot of things get kind of repeated on it. Oh, there's one more guy I'll talk about. He built he was like probably the most noble person I've seen so far in the show. He was like a really old guy now, like a grandfather. And for like since like the 80s, he had been building this like huge underground bunker, like sort of series of bunkers really connected. He made them out of, he bought like 42 school buses and used the buses like as the
like apartments.
Yeah, like as the structure. And apparently like school buses, at least back in the day, like the government regulations that they had to be like built with really, I don't know, durable steel or something. Anyway, his whole point, his whole thing was about like taking people in, but it was like specifically going to be like an orphanage. It was like, cause he's like, he was just very sort of like practical about it. He's like, he kept talking about like serving humanity and stuff, and like not in a religious way, it didn't seem, just like for the sake of, you know, helping people out and like continuing the human race, I guess. And like, obviously like he had a couple delusional ideas. I forget what, I think he was focused on nuclear war, which is like, you know, that's a real possibility, of course. But I felt like he had the most noble thing. Cause like he's old, like he kept saying like, you know, I'm not going to be here that much longer. And like, I want my grandchildren to take over this place. And like, he called it like the Ark 2. And yeah, I don't know. I thought it was like genuinely like a noble idea. And it was like he had spent like his whole retirement, him and his wife, like they didn't take any vacations or buy nice stuff, you know, just put all their money into this.
This also shows a
nuclear just fallout shelter.
Giant distrust for government that seems to permeate throughout America.
That's another like, yeah, one of the phrases you hear all the time on the show is the government's not going to help you, and we rely too much on the government. Like, which again, like, I mean, I think the government's fucked up, but for different reasons. I don't think it's the national debt that's the problem. So yeah, there's definitely like a libertarian streak through a lot of these people, I guess. But I think like you and I talked about this off mic a little bit, but like, it's interesting how almost 100% these same people that say the government's the problem probably were like singing a different tune as soon as their guy got into office, as soon as Trump took over.
Yeah.
Like then the national debt is no longer like the life or death concern that they were making it out to be when Obama was in charge, you know? And like you were saying, like now that kind of rhetoric is coming back immediately now that, you know, Biden's in power, but,
it's being brought up on Fox News constantly again.
I was thinking, yeah. And another thing was like the fear of China, which like there's some reality to that, I guess, but like I don't think there's any reality to the idea of like China invading the United States, which some of these people think about.
But I thought both parties had like fear of China.
They do. And it also made me think of just like the whole, you know, Russiagate is the flip side of that anyway, even though also you're right, like Democrats do that kind of like China bashing shit nowadays as well.
I mean, I loved watching the Chinese oh shit, I forgot his name. Diplomat tear into Blinken about the about America's human rights issues.
Oh, Daddy Rock Blinken. Yeah. That guy sucks so much.
You know, about the way that America has this problem of caging children and letting its public starve and not offering medical care to its citizens, and how China's made massive strides in human rights. You know what? I think both are pretty evil, China and America, but in ways I feel like China's doing a little bit more on the progress foot, but what do I know?
Yeah, I mean, the reason I focus my attention on the U.S. is that's just what I know better than any other countries, like politics and such, but like, yeah, that guy was totally justified in tearing Blinken a new one.
So every bad thing we said about China is also true about them. So, you know,
about who?
Both suck. Oh, I mean, it was a rebuttal to us saying you guys have performed
Oh, yeah, yeah. Just
cyber attacks. You treat some of your citizens the wrong way.
On our high horse. Like,
you do all the same fucking things.
Yeah. And some. I mean, there's some very minor, like, I don't want to say minor, like it doesn't matter, but like in terms of numbers, like in terms of imperialism, like the U.S. is just branching out much more than China ever has, yeah. Really. But anyway, that's like totally different subject, although it's interesting. And fuck Blinken. Fuck Blinken and his fucking high horse shit. I'll just one more thing. He fucking said that the people who did the coup in Bolivia should be freed just for like no reason. And that, you know, there needs to be an independent investigation into whether what they did was legal or not. And Bolivia is doing its own investigation. Like, what he means is like, let the U.S. meddle with all of your stuff even more. I don't know. I just hate that the attitude is so fucking gross. And we're doing the same kind of shit with Iran. But anyway, Doomsday. I think I just had a few more thoughts about Doomsday prepping. Well, one being that, like, there's nothing new about fixating on, like, apocalyptic end-of-the-world stuff either. Like, it's been around since, I guess, all of recorded human history, basically. You know,
I think it's been part of like every society.
Basically, I think that's a safe bet to say without me actually looking into that. But it goes way back. But I think there is also something to the idea that maybe it ramps up at certain times more than others. It's almost like a cliche to point this out, but like there's so much like apocalyptic, media, say. Like, you know, in pop culture, you know, we've got like big action movies or sci-fi movies.
Terminator 2.
Yeah, Terminator 2.
Terminator 2.
I was thinking even like...
technology run amok.
Even like something as dumb as the Transformer movies. An example of like really dumb, big budget shit.
I had a martial arts teacher who I would not be surprised if he's a prepper now or... maybe was a prepper 20 years ago when I was taking kung fu classes. I just remember Eric always being like, duh, duh, duh. You know, the end of the world's coming soon because you watch all these movies and these movies are kind of telling you the truth of what's going to happen to the world. They're like predictions of how the world's going to end. You kind of have to start putting it together.
Was he a 2012 type guy? Was he into the Mayan calendar shit?
I'm sure he was. I mean, but he said they were all like, all these movies were secretly inspired by the Christian God as ways to like warn the people of things that are coming up in the future.
Interesting. That's well thought out theory.
Yeah. I was younger then, but at the time I still was like, yeah, you're really good at fighting. It's cool to learn how to fight from you. These ideals are a bit weird, though.
I guess I just wonder, like, how much these things, like, you know, another examples, like, of, like, big pop culture would be, like, I think of something like The Walking Dead when it was a real phenomenon or whatever, and the whole zombie phenomenon. But then there's just, I mean, there are a lot of, like, dystopian and apocalyptic movies, but it's also, like, in, like, literary fiction and sort of, like, I don't know, more, like, art house cinema even. I remember at one point noticing like a real trend, and it was actually probably around 2012, like coincidentally or not, that I started noticing like all of my favorite books that year, like 8 out of maybe 10 of them were like all dystopian or apocalyptic in some way, even though they were like kind of highfalutin literary fiction shit. So I don't know. I mean, there's so many other explanations too. It's just like, it's becomes a trend. It's marketable. It's just exciting. It just makes for good fiction. It makes for good storytelling. But it also might like signal something about, I don't know, what a society is going through at the moment as well. I think it's just kind of like a little bit of all these things, maybe. And I think it actually puts like, it's helpful to look at like the bigger history of like apocalyptic thinking as a way of realizing like we are not that special.
Yeah.
Because I mean, and like this is a total cliche, but like every generation thinks that it's living in the most interesting or scary or exciting or important time, you know, or like this, what else can come after us? You know, this is the peak. But I think there's definitely something to that as well. Yeah, I don't know. But everyone, and like even people who say that and like know that cliche, still like can't shake the sort of like feeling in their bones that maybe like the apocalyptic feeling, I guess. I don't know.
I'm just worried about a slow environmental apocalypse.
I mean, if I start realistically thinking about it, that's the most likely thing to happen, honestly. There's a quote I like, and I don't have it in front of me, but it comes from a book that I think I've recommended on the show before, Blueprints of the Afterlife. And basically the sentiment is like, yeah, when an individual is like feeling shitty and depressed and like their outlook is totally limited, they sort of project that onto the world at large. So it's like, oh, everything is doomed. But then like, oh, you like fall in love or like you get some, you win the lottery or whatever. And like suddenly the world doesn't look so bad because you're as an individual feeling a lot better. But
sure.
So I always have to kind of like take that into account as well with my own outlooks and moods and stuff, I guess. But like these prepping people, they don't seem like they seem like weirdly positive about a lot of this stuff as well. So I guess I'm not prepper material. I also just don't have any fucking money. That's what I kept thinking about.
I mean, I think that a lot of the prepping really does come from just fear of others.
Yeah.
And it gives them like one more barrier of a way to separate themselves from the marauding poor, as they call them.
Yeah, I think so too. And like, that's why I think it's really important to keep in like, to know like the time that this show was a big hit or whatever. And I don't know, maybe there's probably still like a strong like prepping culture going on somewhere.
I would be surprised if it's gotten stronger.
Yeah. But I think a lot of it is kind of political. So like I was saying, like I think the majority of preppers, I think it's safe to say, are on the conservative side of things. So yeah, it's also just, yeah, it's just sort of like a badge to like distinguish yourself from those stupid Democrats.
Hey, it's obviously all part of the Russian misinformation campaign that Russia has been performing on America for the past 100 years, at least, through every form of electronic gadget ever. They've hacked them, and they convince their strongest, most able-bodied citizens that impending doom is coming, and that they have to trust bigoted leaders and build bunkers and shoot guns at each other. Obviously.
Amen. I know I had I mean, we've been talking for a while. We should just wrap it up here. But I've got just one last thing I want to read from a different article. So they found another article from 2017 that was more focused on like the... they also actually talked to Larry Hall, the guy we've been talking about with his survival condo. But their article was more focused on like the larger phenomenon. And then like specifically with just rich people, like the Silicon Valley people, like the guy who founded Reddit. And yeah, there's like this weird crossover too with like these Silicon Valley douches and like Burning Man people, I guess, at least nowadays.
It's because Burning Man's an evil, evil place for rich fucks to go and do rich fuck things.
Yeah, apparently it used to be more pure. I knew some people in college that were into it, but I don't know. I
doubt it.
Yeah, I don't know.
Thought it was even pure then. I don't know.
I think there was a time when
friends
worked
for Burning Man. I had friends commit suicide because of Burning Man. Jesus. And like, there's like this whole, like underbelly of Burning Man culture where most of their workers, not most of their workers, but a larger percentage than you'd be comfortable with, commit suicide from the stress of working at Burning Man.
Jesus, man, I didn't know that. That's crazy.
The working side of it's the what I was thinking was shitty. I'm sure it's fun. If you're going there as a person going to have fun.
I mean, it's probably not my scene really at all. But any case, we'll save that for the Burning Man episode that will probably never exist. Well, maybe it will. That sounds like something to look into, actually, what you just told me. It's really fucked up. I didn't know about that. In any case, this is just a little bit from that article that kind of rounds out some of what I was trying to say about what these trends really signify or whatever. So here goes. Why do our dystopian urges emerge at certain moments and not others? Doomsday, as a prophecy, a literary genre, and a business opportunity, is never static. It evolves with our anxieties. The earliest Puritan settlers saw in the awe-inspiring bounty of the American wilderness the prospect of both apocalypse and paradise. That's the, I immediately thought of the Adam Curtis documentary. The, you know, he talked about the paranoia of like the early settlers.
Yeah.
Creating conspiracy theories. It goes on to say, when in May of 1780, sudden darkness settled on New England, farmers perceived it as a cataclysm heralding the return of Christ. In fact, the darkness was caused by enormous wildfires in Ontario. D.H. Lawrence diagnosed a specific strain of American dread. Doom, 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 he wrote in 1923. Something seems to whisper it in the very dark trees of America. Historically, our fascination with the end has flourished at moments of political insecurity and rapid technological change. In the late 19th century, there were all sorts of utopian novels, and each was coupled with a dystopian novel, Richard White, a historian at Stanford University, told me. Edward Bellamy's Looking Backward, published in 1888, depicted a socialist paradise in the year 2000. I'm kind of curious to check that book out, actually. And became a sensation, inspiring Bellamy clubs around the country. Conversely, Jack London in 1908 published The Iron Heel, imagining an America under a fascist oligarchy in which 0.9% hold 70% of the total wealth. That's crazy. That could never happen. Anyway, that's what I pulled out of the article there. So yeah, I think it's like, it helps put things into perspective to like know that people were writing these same tortured, doom laden novels, even, I don't know, 200 years ago or whatever.
Fuck, that's what the Bible is, dude.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, if, like I said, like, it goes back to like the, all of the, you know, as early as like recorded human history can go back to probably. But yeah, I mean, Revelation for sure is the rantings of a prepper.
Yeah,
basically. Oh man, I just remembered one of my good friends just reading from the book of Revelation. Like, we were all fucked up at a party once, just like a house party. It was really funny. It's one of the main things I think of when I think of that crazy book of the Bible. Anyway, shout out to Drew with his wonderful reading of the book of Revelation.
My recommendation tonight is to read the book of Revelations at a house party, because I've also done
this. Really?
Went over with great success.
Great minds.
Just drunk, loud, do your best impression of whatever annoying Billy Graham preacher you can do.
That's funny. That's cool. That makes me know for sure we would have been friends back in the day.
I have actually a very good memory of doing that.
I have a good memory of watching my friend do it. So yeah, I guess that's where to call it. And that's your recommendation, huh?
That's my recommendation.
It's a good recommendation. I will recommend a book. For some reason, I'm recommending this book called After the Apocalypse. I don't know why. I don't know what made me think of it.
I don't know why either. Makes no sense.
It's a really good short story book by an author named Maureen McHugh, who I only know this book by her. I must have read it a while ago. Oh, this was, again, back in 2012 in January when I was reading all those apocalyptic books. Although her book is called After the Apocalypse. So, I mean, there's some apocalyptic shit. I'll quickly give a little summary of some of the stories because some of them are really interesting. So I wrote a review on Goodreads for it. I'm not reading the whole review, of course, just a quick summary of the stories. There's just a few. First, violent sociopathic criminals struggle against the elements and each other in a cliche-free and grittily realistic zombie narrative. It's not really zombie-ish. And it's kind of like off-putting to put that as the first thing, but she's a really good writer. The second story, which I really love, and I would recommend reading the book and just reading, even if you're only going to read this story, is about Chinese biotech factory workers who dance on street corners to Sri Lankan hip hop and battle their corporate master's cycle of tyrannical debt. It's about like the real phenomenon of like people like living in factories and like just like being trapped in a cycle of debt, like owing the factory money for like living there and basically never being able to get out of it, which is insane. Another one, a woman's internet business branches out from making infant dolls for bereaved parents into more lucrative adult-only goods while dealing with the struggle between being kind to strangers, down on their luck, and having to be more suspicious and reserved towards said strangers out of rational self-preservation. Even if it was just a story about someone making realistic dolls of babies that had died to give to parents, that would be fucked up in its own, but that would turns into something so much more insane and weird. Another one, I'll skip a couple of these, but there's one about like these people creating artificial intelligence and like how it's like weird and a failure. It's pretty interesting. Another one, a McDonald's employee asserts herself, undergoes the risks of being a guinea pig for medical research, and takes herself on a honeymoon. Another one is about mad cow disease, like just ripping through the entire country, which is pretty terrifying. And then the last one is just about, is actually like apocalyptic, about like an apocalyptic event and then that sort of the aftermath. But it's actually like, it's probably fucked up and dark as all that sounded. It's like pretty funny as well. And like well-rounded. It's not just like this grim book. And like, she kind of like bounces around between genres a little bit. Like I wouldn't call it really literary fiction exactly, but it's got like sci-fi elements and then just like kind of regular old fiction elements. And strong recommend. I should actually reread it, honestly. It's been a while. But yeah, After the Apocalypse, Maureen F. McHugh.
All right. Let's say goodbye.
It's late.
I'm tired.
It is late. So we'll be back with the continuation of this episode in a way. We set you up for some NRA stuff, and it's gonna pay off on the next episode.
We'll talk about it next time.
And we have a website
next time,
which is heatdeathpod.com, and we have a Twitter account at heatdeathpod, and you should send us your thoughts about prepping. Have you ever prepped for the end of the world? Would you, if you had the money, would you live in a luxury inverted condo in an abandoned missile silo and so on? All right, I'm pretty tired too, even though I just drank all this fucking coffee.
I'll see you later.
All right, take care. See ya.
Darkness, right, by Lord Byron. I had a dream, which was not all a dream. The bright sun was extinguished, and the stars did wander darkling in the eternal space, rayless and pathless, and the icy earth swung blind and blackening in the moonless air. Morn came and went and came and brought no day, and men forgot their passions in the dread of this, their desolation, and all hearts were chilled into a selfish prayer for light, and they did live by watchfires, and the thrones, the palaces of crowned kings, the huts, the habitations of all things which dwell, were burnt for beacons. Cities were consumed, and men were gathered round their blazing homes to look once more into each other's faces. Happy were those who dwelt within the eye of the volcano, and their mountain torch. A fearful hope was all the world contained. Forests were set on fire, but hour by hour they fell and faded, and the crackling trunks extinguished with a crash. And all was black. The brows of men by the despairing light wore an unearthly aspect, as by fates and flashes fell upon them. Some lay down and hid their eyes and wept, and some did rest, their chins upon their clenched hands, and smiled. And others hurried to and fro and fed their funeral piles with fuel and looked up with mad disquietude on the dull sky, the pall of a past world, and then again with curses cast them down upon the dust and gnashed their teeth and howled. The wild birds shrieked and terrified did flutter on the ground and flap their useless wings. The wildest brutes came tame and tremulous, and vipers crawled and twined themselves among the multitude, hissing, but stingless. They were slain for food, and war, which for a moment was no more, did glut himself again. A meal was bought with blood, and each sate sullenly apart, gorging himself in gloom. No love was left. All earth was but one thought, and that was death, immediate and inglorious, and the pang of famine fed upon all entrails. Men died, and their bones were tombless as their flesh. The meager by the meager were devoured. Even dogs assailed their masters, all save one, and he was faithful to a corpse, and kept the birds and beasts and famished men at bay, till hunger clung them, or the dropping dead lured their lank jaws. Himself sought out no food, but with a piteous and perpetual moan, and a quick, desolate cry, licking the hand which answered not with a caress, he died. The crowd was famished by degrees, but two of an enormous city did survive, and they were enemies. They met beside the dying embers of an altar place where had been heaped a mass of holy things for an unholy usage. They raked up and, shivering, scraped with their cold skeleton hands the feeble ashes, and their feeble breath blew for a little life and made a flame which was a mockery. Then they lifted up their eyes as it grew lighter and beheld each other's aspects, saw and shrieked and died. Even of their mutual hideousness they died, unknowing who he was, upon whose brow famine had written fiend. The world was void. The populace and the powerful was a lump, seasonless, herbless, treeless, manless, lifeless, a lump of death, a chaos of hard clay. The rivers, lakes, and ocean all stood still, and nothing stirred within their silent depths. Ships, sailorless, lay rotting on the sea, and their masts fell down piecemeal. As they dropped, they slept on the abyss without a surge. The waves were dead. The tides were in their grave. The moon, their mistress, had expired before. The winds were withered in the stagnant air, and the clouds perished. Darkness had no need of aid from them. She was the universe.
The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Au Clair de la Lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it?